The dark tried to hide you and steal you away. Death tried to keep you inside of the grave. The enemy fought you, he tried but he lost. You cannot be stopped. When we cried for freedom, you tore down the walls. The weight of our burdens, you carried it all. Failures hang dead on the cross. You cannot be stopped. Move the mountains, breaker of chains. Jesus is triumphed over the grave. Sing hallelujah, the battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. We stand on your victory and we shout out your praise. Miracle maker, you're mighty to save. Awesome in power, relentless in love. Oh, you cannot be stopped. Mover of mountains, breaker of chains. Jesus is triumphed over the grave. Sing hallelujah, the battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. Can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There is nothing. There is nothing.
You cannot be stopped.
There's nothing that can stop our God.
You cannot be strong.
There's nothing that can stop our God.
You're fighting.
Stop us.
There's nothing that can stop our God.
Just ask the waves if they are still at the mention of his name. They'll say, my God is still the same. Ask the walls if they still fall at the mighty sound of praise. They'll say, my God is still the same. When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will, my God is still the same. When did he lose his power? Change.
Good morning, Connect Church. So it is definitely summer in North Dakota, right? So we have a lot of people that are gone, but welcome to all of you that are here. And for those that are joining us online, hey, welcome. We're so glad you're tuning in this morning. And I have a couple announcements. I'm Pastor Joanne, and I am kind of excited to be back. I've been gone the last two Sundays. And so it's been really good chatting with everybody, seeing everybody. I just love you all. So anyway, I have a couple announcements. If you have your Connect news there, we got Music in the Park coming up. And I forgot to bring my other sheet. But that's coming up on your sheet. It says July 23rd. There it is. Right there at 10 a.m. And we're going to have a meal, so people are going to be bringing in. You see, if you know what your last name is there, it says what. But the MNU Relentless Band will be here, and they always do a phenomenal job. They will be here because they will then be heading the next day to Crystal Springs for our youth camp. And so plan to join us. Let's pray for great weather, and let's all just gather. Summer challenge for the kids. I don't know who here has been doing the summer challenge. Any of you kids, can you raise your hand? Are you doing the challenge? Are you doing it? Oh, okay, Axel, I see Lexi. I see a few hands over there. All right, so let's keep doing the summer challenge. And, you know, August is going to be here before you know it. So let's keep on that. Also, I am here this morning because I would like to give you guys an update on what's happening in the lower level of the church. Now, if you are new here this morning or you're not aware, we did a capital campaign and we raised funds to totally renovate the lower level for our Connect kids. And there's been a lot going on behind the scenes. So I'm going to give you a little short synopsis of where we're at, where we're going, what our end goal is. So downstairs, the current room that we have been using for Connect Kids, I am going to refer to as the small worship area. That area is going to be where our three-year-olds, oh, I see Christy's here. I should have you do this, Christy. This is where our three-year-olds through our pre-K kiddos. They are going to stay in that room from dismissal all the way through. There's going to be a stage area down there. There's going to be a learning area. If you've been down there, we've already got the, Terry Lassiter came in and painted for us. He did the walls and the ceiling. And Ryan Johnson did clouds down there. We have a picket fence that's going to go around that room and then section it off. That's ordered. We need to get that put together yet. And we have activity panels down there that have been ordered. We have one on back order. Those will be mounted on the walls. It's going to be super cool in there. And then, if I'm going to take you now, I'm going to take you into the fellowship area where the kitchen is. The end of that room is going to be our large worship area. If you have been down there, you have seen that it has been painted. Terry Lassiter again came in. He had painted all of that, the base of all that. And Ryan Johnson has been coming in, and he's painting really cool murals down there. So if you want to take a peek at that, they're not anywhere near being done, but they're in the process, and you can get a good idea of what's happening down there. Randy McGinnity from RPM Sound, who did all of our sound up here, and who we love working with him, he is doing all of our sound and audio and lights down there. He has been here already to do the phase one of the install, so he has done all of the lights, and the TVs are up down there. You can take a look. They're covered right now because we are still working down there. So moving ahead, for the large worship area, we're still working on finishing the front of the stage area. We are also working on building a welcome counter for down there, welcome counter. And a check-in counter. We're going to build a wall down there. If you've been down there, you'll probably see some tape on the floor. And that's where we're going to have a wall with a 10-foot opening that will accommodate that whole area if we need to open that up for funerals, whatever we have going on. There'll be barn doors there. And then also we need to install the carpet there. So that's one of the... The carpet needs to go in, and then the very last phase of getting that area ready will be Randy from RPM coming back and completing all the sound. because we don't want anything, the sound has to have everything done, and so we have no dust in the air or anything like that. The two side rooms that we have down there, which used to be referred to as the barn room and the blast room, if you knew, that was one big giant room. And we put just kind of some makeshift dividers in there. We now have a wall there, a really nice door, and we also have that carpeted. That just got done as well. So that's been done. Those two rooms will accommodate small groups. There'll be multi-purpose reasons, things that will happen in those rooms. I'm trying to make sure I've explained everything to you. And I think I have. I've given you a good overview of what's going on, but we have some dates coming up, and that's the 17th and 18th, that we are going to have people that just want to come in and help us, and we have 48 chairs that need to be put together. We have odds and ends, other things, so if you could just keep in mind to have those dates set aside to come in and help us. I just know that when we have a lot of people together and you bring your tools, we can get a lot done, and we'll hopefully have some other things that might need to happen there. Our design team is made up of Christy Tate Anderson, myself, Pastor John, Dolores Manson, Ryan Johnson. So we've been working really hard behind the scenes, just putting this all together. And that's why Pastor John wanted me to spend a few moments today explaining to you where that process is. So we are super excited. Our kickoff for Connect Kids is September 10th. So we are on a time crunch to get all these things done. So we really hope that you can come in and help us with some of those things that are coming up. One last thing before I pray and open us up today. I need about 5 or 6 guys or strong women or women that just don't mind moving some things around. We need to, we need to put tables and chairs back from the funeral that happened this last week for Floyd. And so if you could just follow, head down right as the service ends, it's not gonna take long, but it sure will help me to try so that one person doesn't have to do that all. So that's it for me. So let's go ahead after I've spent all this time talking. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, you are so, so good. And God, that I can even get up and share all this with the congregation this morning. Because Father, together, corporately, Father, you provided through your people, God, to be able to do this. And Father, we are anticipating, God, great things for our kids and for our families of Connect Church. Families that probably aren't even engaged here yet, Father. God, that is what we see, Father. We see a church alive with children. We see a church alive with sharing the gospel to these kiddos. We see, God, families that are changed for you, God, through this vision of the lower level. Father God, we even pray for that next person coming in to be our leader in the children's department. Father, we know this is completely in your hands, and we are so excited, Father, to be on this path, God. And Father, as we gather here today, Father, some of us have maybe come in feeling a little broken, maybe feeling a little like just not themselves, God. Maybe, God, there's so many reasons why we come in some mornings and just don't feel you, Father. And so, God, I pray that this morning that would change, that people would be engaged. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would touch each one here. God, I pray, even as we sing, Father, as we worship you, God, as we hear a message from Pastor John, Father, I pray, God, that we would set aside, Father, our thoughts, our worries, our judgments, and just listen to what the Holy Spirit has for us. Father, you are such a good, good Father. And we are so blessed, Father, to know you and to serve you, Father. So God, we give you this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, church family. Would you please stand and worship with us?
Thank you. Take a seat. Before we go to prayer this morning, in the Church of the Nazarene, we believe that all believers are called to do ministry. And so every believer should be, you know, we want to help people figure out what, how they're gifted, how they're wired, how their experiences, and all those kinds of things all kind of go with doing ministry, because God has called all of us, every believer, to do ministry. We also believe in the Nazarene Church that God has a special calling on people's lives, where he literally calls people into ministry, like men and women. He'll just call them to a lifetime, a vocation of ministry. Kind of like becoming a pastor, and there's all kinds of different ways that you could be called and how God calls. And what's really neat is what's really powerful is when God calls certain individuals. It's neat because it's affirmed by the church, and it's just an amazing thing to be called by God. And I can just tell you that from experience. And I literally fought the call. Like, I was like, I don't think I want to do that. And then when I finally surrendered it all to Him, God called me into ministry. But the neat thing is here at Connect Church, God has called one of our own into the ministry. And so I'm gonna invite Josh Jorison to come up here, if you would. And so just to give you an idea of the call to ministry, it's like an inner conviction that God has on your life. And it's almost like He puts the thumb in your bag and says, man, you got to do this. And I had a guy tell me one time, don't do it unless you have to. and I didn't understand what he meant by at that time, but now I do. As I answered that call for my own life. And Josh is answering the call of God in his life to minister in a vocational sense. So isn't that cool? Yeah. And so just to let you know that our church board unanimously voted to give him a local minister's license. And what that means is he's going into the ministry. And we are actually, this fall, he'll be enrolling into start taking classes to prepare for ministry. And obviously he has a wife that supports him. That's really, 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 really important. And so that's good, right? Yes. And I don't know if, like, we don't have time today, but if you've never heard his story, it's an amazing story. He and Danielle's story of what God has raised them up out of. And it just goes to show you that it doesn't matter how far down you are, God can lift you up and He can call you to do something that you never thought you could do. And it's all over in the Bible, you know. So anyway, we are excited. He's going to come alongside and we're going to give him ministry opportunities here at Connect Church, which is really cool. He's already started to do some of that, visiting with people, and feels like he's got some minister of care thing going on, and he's into discipleship and prayer. And so this is really cool, and the timing of everything, the way God times things, is really cool. So I'm just going to give him a couple minutes here just to kind of share a little bit about his call.
Hello. So
too close to you, maybe.
So I was called about a year ago, and I was already in a place of just deep communion with God. So you hear so many stories of people getting that call and then they just wrestle with it, like, you know, there's no way, you know, you've got the wrong guy. And I think it's just because he'd been showing me for about 6 months already. And if I'm being honest, I think he called me 8 years ago when I was saved, as I think I've shared with you and some others. But I didn't understand it. But going back to about a year ago, just deep communion with God. Then I just had to, I think I was trying to figure out on my own almost, like, okay, what am I supposed to do with this? I don't know where I go from here. Should have went to my pastor and just talked to him. God still worked it out, and I started doing Facebook ministry, honestly. And there's ministry everywhere. You know, Facebook, social media, there's enough junk on those platforms that we need to shine light in all of the areas. As long as it exists for people to get on, there has to be good there too.
Amen.
Yeah, amen. But as far as what the call is, God's raised me up to be a preacher. And that's straight from God, because He's the one who gives me a voice. Like, I've never really had a voice of my own. But Yeah, his voice. And with a heavy emphasis on teaching. I've known I was a teacher for 20-some years. I just didn't know what I was supposed to teach. So I was waiting for him to show me. Yeah.
Isn't that exciting? I'm just so thankful to God that he still calls men and women into ministry. And so we want to pray. I want to pray for Josh. And would you just join me in praying for him and praying as he begins his ministry here at Connect, that God will just raise him up, give him everything that he needs. And yeah, let's do it. Father God, we just thank you for this day. We thank you so much. We are just reminded of your grace, God. No matter how far gone we may seem, or somebody seems, Jesus, you came to redeem people. And I thank you for your redemption in Josh's life. And part of that redemption is to now take everything that he's been through and to use it for your glory. I thank you for the call on his life. I thank you, God, that he has a relationship with you, that he was attentive to your Holy Spirit, that he listened to you. And God, I just pray over he and Danielle and their family. God, I just pray for your protection. Lord, I pray that the enemy would not be allowed to come in between their marriage or in their family. I just pray, God, that you would just move in their lives. And I pray that you should continue to grow him. As we give him opportunities, God, I pray that you would just use him for your purposes, for your kingdom. And your kingdom will be more populated because you've called this man into the ministry and he's answered that call. And Lord, I pray that you just equip him with everything that he needs to do what you've called him to do. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that is at work in this church and what you're doing in his life. And I pray that his ministry would flourish in this place, all over in this community. God, you have big plans for them. And so, God, we just thank you for that. We love you today, and we thank you for the opportunity for us to be here today. And we pray that your word would just come alive to us today. And just thank you for your Holy Spirit today. Help us to listen to what you have to say to us today, God. Give us ears to hear. Help us to be slow to speak and quick to hear. And help us to apply everything that you have for us today to our own lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Love you, man. You need a picture. Well, that's good stuff, isn't it? Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to continue in our series. We've been talking about the art of thriving. James, who is actually the brother of Jesus, wrote a book called the Book of James in the New Testament. Oh, that was funny, wasn't it? But James was a leader of the Jerusalem church. And one of the reasons why he wrote this book is because he really wanted to encourage the church, the believers. He wanted to encourage them to live out their faith. And I would argue, not just to live out their faith, but thrive in their faith. To live out their faith in a way that that even though they experience all kinds of different things, and this church, the Jerusalem church, was experiencing all kinds of issues and experiencing all kinds of persecution and suffering and all of that. And so James writes this book, and this is not just for the Jerusalem church. This is for the church, period. And that's why this book is still around, the Bible, because God has a lot to say to us. And James is, it's just really interesting because in The Art of Thriving, James reveals to us an attitude that we should just embrace. That no matter what's going on in your life, the attitude is so important and also a resource to ask for. That God is literally the resource of everything that we need. Literally everything. And then also that we would trust God to understand what he's doing. Because I don't know about you, but there's many times when I've scratched my head and say, Lord, what in the world is going on here? And so getting God's perspective and learning to trust him through those things is really important. I was thinking back this week about when I was studying for ministry, you know, on the God's call on my life. And I was at Mid-America Nazarene University, and my advisor just happened to be the division chair of the religion department, Dr. Frank Moore. And Dr. Frank Moore taught systematic theology. And basically he taught, so there's two requirements. There was systematic theology one, systematic theology two. And you had to, and it was required for every ministry student. And at the end of the first semester, he told us, all of us ministry students, he said that he was going on sabbatical and he was going to be writing a book, and the book that he wrote was called Coffee Shop Theology, which basically is a book that you could just like go to Alley Beans and like read it together and talk about it. And so anyway, he said he wouldn't be there for the second semester, and we're like, what? And then he said, but we have a treat for you, because he said, we have a guy who's going to come in and teach you systematic theology too. It sounds boring, but it's actually really exciting. It's good stuff, trust me. You know, this, the study of God and all of understanding God and his ways and all that. But anyway, he told us that Dr. Donald Metz would be coming to teach us the second semester. He was one of the founders of Mid-America Nazarene University, which was Mid-America Nazarene College at that time. And obviously, he was the former theology teacher years and years and years ago. And this guy was in his 80s, and like he was as sharp as a tack. He literally wrote the book, one of the books that we required in our second semester. And it was just really interesting listening to him and just gleaning from him just so much. And then we talked about the whole problem of evil and suffering in this world. And that was really interesting to listen to him talk about that, because really those are the questions that we've been pondering for so long. And one of the questions is, why do bad things happen to good people if God rules the world? Why does that happen? But you understand that the questions about suffering and loss and being perplexed about all of this has been troubling people for 1,000 years since the birth of Christ. I mean, even ancient philosophers reasoned that suffering isn't really bad, but offers people the opportunity to prove their true moral character. That's what some of the philosophers would say. And then there's like modern secular thinkers that conclude God, if he's out there, because they don't really believe, can't keep good people from harm, and we must make the best of suffering even if we don't understand it. Then you have Hinduism. They explain that unfolding of karma brings physical and mental suffering for people, and you just have to accept it and just endure it. And then you come to the Old Testament, and you have ancient Jewish writers who interpreted Israel's sufferings as God's chastisement for their sins, which required repentance and a lot of sacrifices that went on. Which explains why the disciples struggled as they came to Jesus one day. And what was happening in John chapter 9, John's gospel, is that it says that one day that Jesus was just kind of, he just kind of went along. The disciples were following him, and they were doing ministry, and they were moving along, and all of a sudden he saw a blind man from birth. Jesus just knew that he was blind from birth. Nobody told him. Okay? And his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents, that this has happened to him?" Jesus said, "This has happened so that the work of God might be displayed in him for God's purposes." It's interesting, isn't it? Jesus' perspective on suffering and the anguish that family probably went through. And of course, Jesus ended up spitting in the ground and taking some mud and putting on him, his eyes, and then he could see. It's one of his miracles that he did, right? When you get to the Christian perspective of suffering, facing adversity, going through all kinds of trials, and listen, we've all been through trials. Some of you have been experiencing trials and adversity in your life. Some of you are listening online. You're facing adversity. You have faced adversity throughout your life. But the Christian perspective on suffering is really cross-shaped. It's suffering is just cross-shaped. That's what it is. You say, "Pastor John, what do you mean by that?" The Christian understanding of suffering centers on the cross of Jesus. This is where it all comes from. And you see, at the cross, it was Jesus fulfilled the Father's plan of redemption, right? But he had to suffer, right? But it was all about a plan of redemption, to save people of their sins. It's also to rescue his church. There's this whole plan. You see, it's a big plan. And God is rescuing his church for all of those who believe. And in fact, he'll usher that in to the end, where you understand that there won't be any suffering at all. That's God's promise and his plan for our future. And Christians still suffer, though, don't they? We all do. We still suffer through this cursed, broken world that we live in. And this world is broken because of sin. And you know, there's a lot of people who, and I remember the old-timers. Back, I grew up in the church, and I remember the old-timers praying, "Oh, how long, oh Lord? How long are we going to have to wait?" And I even heard some guys, when I was young, say, "Come, Lord Jesus. Come back." I don't know if you've ever prayed that prayer. But have you ever had those moments where you just, like, you're just done with it, and you're just like, "You know what? I just wish Jesus would just come back and rescue us." And so, this whole idea of suffering is cross-shaped. And until Christ returns, we are to pick up our cross and follow Jesus right to Calvary, where he suffered and died. So Christ's crucifixion is the foundation and focus of the Christian understanding of suffering. Sometimes we ask questions about all that, right? And also, it's strange to a lot of most of all the other worldviews, this whole idea of Christians understanding that we have to suffer. But Jesus embraced it, didn't he? Right? Jesus embraced suffering as a necessary destiny for his life. Jesus literally was born in this world, right? And he was destined to die. He was destined to suffer. And in fact, in Matthew chapter 16, Matthew writes about this. And Jesus taught his disciples. And this is what he said. He said, and it says, he says it this way. He said, he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. Jesus taught his disciples that. Now, what's really interesting is the Greek word for must is dia, D-E-I. And this word is used here and then oftentimes in the Gospels, talking about Jesus must. It's this whole idea of divine necessity. That's Jesus, right? And so Jesus states plainly that his passion is God's plan. And so his teaching shocked the disciples. Literally shocked them. In fact, when Jesus began to talk about this, Peter rebuked him. Not on my watch. Nope, not going to happen. Never going to happen, Jesus. This shall never happen to you. And Jesus neither avoids suffering as Peter demands, nor minimizes the agony that awaits him. Instead, what Jesus does is he sets his face towards Jerusalem, because this is where it's all going to go down. And he knows that that's where he's headed. He knows that's his destiny here on earth. And so, you know, the city, Jerusalem, as Luke records, the city that kills the prophets. That city. And because Jesus follows the script of the scriptures on the night of his arrest, listen to what he says. Jesus declared, I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in me. And he was numbered with the transgressors. See, he was quoting straight out of Isaiah 53 about what is written about me has its fulfillment. That Jesus would go through all of that. He was destined. Now consider this for a moment. I just want to spend a couple minutes with this. Consider this for a moment, the multiple ways that Jesus suffered. He experienced, as he faithfully fulfilled the Father's plan, he experienced the agonizing of going to the cross when he was in the garden. Literally, the pressure that was on him caused him to sweat drops of blood. That is pressure. That's when the weight of the world, the weight of sin is on you. And to drink that dreaded cup of divine judgment, God's judgment on sin. It's not some small thing that God did when he sent Jesus to the cross, is it? It's his divine judgment on sin. And then what happened in that garden? His closest friends, those who were with him, those who he had been walking with for 2.5 to 3 years, they slept while he's agonizing. And they betrayed him, and they denied him, and they deserted him. All the way through his arrest and trial. And the Romans, brutal. The Romans slandered him, spit on him, beat him, whipped him, and shamed him. Put a crown of thorns on him, said, Hail, King of the Jews. They just mocked him and maligned him and said, Crucify this guy. Crucify him. And the Gospels state, matter-of-factly, it was there, Luke says, they crucified him at Calvary. James, first century readers, and the rest of these first century people, they did not need elaboration when it came to understanding what crucified meant. So James comes along. The church is going through difficulty. The church is experiencing persecution. There's people that are suffering. There's people experiencing poverty. There's all kinds of trouble and trials going on. And James knew that the church needed some encouragement, that they needed to understand some things, and they needed to get God's perspective on suffering. And so James, in chapter 1, verse 12, returns to the theme that he talked about in verse 2 of James that we've already covered. And this is what he says. Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, or under that kind of pressure of trials. Because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. It's a powerful verse, isn't it? You understand that how we respond to suffering, how we respond to trials and adversity and difficulties, says a lot about what we believe. And James is trying to get us to understand something about suffering through trials, persevering through the hard things. And, you know, not just what we believe about God, but understanding the whole framework and the thoughts about God's nature and what he's trying to do with our lives. And the thing is, God has big plans for us, and sometimes we have to go through difficult things to get to where he wants us to be. And that's just really hard for us sometimes to understand. And so if you're sitting here today and maybe you're discouraged about some things, or maybe there's some things happening in your life and you're kind of stuck in this discouragement, perhaps you have the wrong perspective. And James is trying to get us to understand there's another perspective that you need to think about. And discouragement, you understand that discouragement is one of the tools of the enemy. I mean, he literally wants to discourage people. He wants you to throw in the towel. He wants you to give up. As soon as you go through some difficult things, he wants you to push that eject button. You are most susceptible to discouragement when your perspective is off. And God has a perspective that he wants you to get a hold of. Because when your perspective is off, that's when you think, you know what, I am all alone and nobody understands a thing that I'm going through. And that no one cares and nothing's working, you're probably not seeing things real clear. And the enemy will capitalize on that, and he will get you to erode our confidence in God. And God wants people of faith. People of faith is that we have confidence in God, that no matter what we face, he is the sovereign God of the universe. He is in control. Do we believe that when we're going through all that difficulty? And some people, it just causes them to lose heart. Like, what's the use? Nothing is ever going to change. What's the use of me even going through this? What's the point of even trying? Some of you have experienced some excruciating things. Some of you have lost children or lost loved ones. That's one of the most difficult things to go through. God can take that and he can turn that whole thing around. He just can. Even when quitting seems like the most realistic option, God can turn it all around. But you see, God provides us with a different understanding. of him. A different kind of theology, basically. And it's divine perspective. See, left to myself, I can't understand things. I can't understand what's happening. But you see, you bring God into the equation, and you begin to get his perspective on things, it changes everything. Everything. And his perspective is all about how much he loves us and how much he holds our future in his hands. That's his perspective. That's his. And when you let God's perspective get a hold of you, you begin to start seeing the things the way God sees them. You get the divine perspective. I'm telling you, discouragement will lose its power. I know that for a fact in my own life. So are you discouraged today? You probably need to get God's perspective. Trust in who he is and what he says and his promises, right? So I want to talk to you just for a few minutes about getting God's perspective on a few things. First of all, on your circumstances that you're in right now. See, looking at your circumstances is really important through the eyes of faith, the eyes of trusting God. The writer of Hebrews, and I love that book, but the writer of Hebrews gives us an example of Abraham and Sarah having the eyes of faith, which means they trusted God enough to go to a foreign land. And this is how the Hebrews writer says in verse 8 of chapter 11, the faith chapter. He said, by faith, Abraham, when he was called to go to a place he would later receive as an inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. That's trust, right? I mean, it's hard to comprehend that kind of trust that Abraham had in order to move 500 miles away from a place he'd never been. I mean, that's trust, right? That's trust. And then God promises Abraham and Sarah that whole promise that he had to go to this place, and that because he had big plans and he was going to do this great thing, and he basically said, you know what, it's all about your earthly future and what you're going to leave here. And he promised children, but not just several children, billions of children. I mean, he said, go look out, look at the stars in the sky. And it's hard to comprehend that too, you know. But the thing is, the problem was they were still childless. And so now they were going to have to continue to trust God. And listen, you read through that story and it's excruciating. The things that they go through and unfulfilled promises and wondering if this is ever going to happen, and time seems to be running out. I mean, my wife's getting old and she's without child and she's beyond years, and you know, it almost seems cruel, right? I don't know if you ever think about it that way, but it almost seems cruel. But from God's perspective, you know, the promise was so extravagant. And he's a God who keeps promises, doesn't he? And so Abraham, and from Sarah's viewpoint, the reality looked so hopeless in one sense, and she was barren, and it was like there was this disconnect. But they were invited to see through the eyes of faith, the eyes of trusting God for the impossible. You understand what I'm saying today? When things seem so bleak, yeah. Learn to trust God in the midst of pressure. Learning to trust him through it all, because blessed is he who perseveres. Perseveres. And we're going to get to that blessing, right? You see, circumstances, if you think of it this way, they're putting you in a position on depending on God. You understand what I'm saying? You see, your circumstances are putting you in a position to depend on God, which is a priceless skill right here on this earth and all the way into eternity, to depend on Him completely. You also, you and I, we need God's perspective, and James is talking about this, because not only that, but your future. You need God's perspective on the future. See, so often we just think of this life as you know, that we're just going to live forever and ever, and right here on earth, and boy, time goes by, doesn't it? I think my oldest is going to be 37 years old. Wow. Where did time go? I remember when he was born. Your future. See, we're called to look at our future with the eyes of hope. And that's not just some small thing. It's hope through God's perspective. One of my life verses is Philippians 4:13. I could do all things through Christ who gives me strength. So that was one of the very first verses that I ever, outside of John 3:16, that I memorized. It became my life verse, but understanding that I can go through whatever through Him who gives me strength. But I was reading the Message the other day, and listen to this. And I'm going to read verse 14 to you too, through the Message, but this is how it reads, and I like this. Whatever I have, wherever I am, I can make it through anything in the one who makes me who I am. I love that. And then he says, I don't mean that your help didn't mean a lot to me, as he's talking to the church in Philippi. It did. It was a beautiful thing that you came alongside me in my troubles. And that's part of the church too, right? That we come along with you through difficulty. That's really important, right? Absolutely. I mean, if you're a believer in Jesus, and if you've not sure if you've considered that, I just want you to know that you will never go through painful circumstances that are not worth it. It doesn't seem worth it when you're going through that. But when you get to the other side of that and you persevere and you trust God with that, all of a sudden that just changes everything. Because you have to trust getting His perspective, and you have to be able to see your future through God's perspective. And it brings tremendous hope for us, doesn't it? Lacey Buchanan had been asked a question that most mothers never expect to hear. After learning of her newborn son's disabilities, people wondered, even asked Lacey, why she decided to keep her son instead of aborting. And of course, Lacey had an answer for all of those questions. But as she blogged, she explains a little bit about what happened. She said, on February 18, 2011, our lives were changed forever when our son, Christian Taylor Buchanan, entered the world. She said he was born with bilateral cleft palate and lip and almost completely blind. Lacey blogged the story of his life, the joys that they shared, the challenges that they encountered, and the amazing and trying journey ahead for their family. She was literally, through her blog, bringing hope to a whole bunch of people who were experiencing all kinds of stuff with their families. When Christian was born, she took some pictures. And there's one specific picture that she kept and she remembered. It was a picture of him, face all messed up. She said, everything was so chaotic that I didn't even think about taking pictures. There was so much heartache and so much pain I could barely breathe. I wasn't thinking about taking pictures. It's the last thing on my mind. But she said, but now looking back, I wish I had taken so many more. Although a certain picture was taken during that time when my heart felt like it would literally break, I look back on this photo with so much joy. Reaching the point where heartache is a memory instead of a fresh wound takes a lot of time, faith, and work. She said, but I can say this, that's where I'm at. I look back at the photos of those darkest days of my life, and I smile. Will I still feel the deep ache and so much empathy for the me who went through that? I can smile because the flames didn't consume me like I thought they would. And then she said this, God replaced my ashes for beauty in a way I couldn't imagine while I was drowning in heartache. Wow. And so she talks about heartache and she gives credit to God's faithfulness to bring her through that. And there's still challenges today. I think he's like 12 years old. But God's faithfulness to walk me through it, she said, and to see me to the other side where I can dance upon the heartache instead of being consumed by it. That's hope for the future. God's got this, right? And there's one last thing. As James is talking about persevering under trial, then comes the motivation. He called it the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. Let me ask you this morning, do you love God? I mean, do you really, really love him? Do you have this, this might sound weird, but do you have this love affair with God? Here's the promise. The crown of life is promised to those who love him. See, that's the motivation. The reason why we're willing to go through the things that we go through in this life and we stay faithful to God and we stay intact with our relationship with God, the reason why we can persevere is because we love him. And you see, that whole thing of love, the crown of life is promised to those who love him. And there's this overarching motive that anchors our vision for eternity. It's an eternal perspective. There's a reward for those who endure. The reward for those who persevere and stay with it. Stay with your faith. Stay in tune with God. I was thinking about this whole crown of life. James, what are you talking about, this crown of life? The word there, crown of life, alludes to a crown that's given to winners at athletic games. Paul said, it's a crown that will last forever in eternity. Now, I don't claim to completely understand this, but here's what I know. It's eternal life with abundant blessings. That's what it is. Huge blessings of God through eternity that the Lord has promised to those because, get this, God recognizes when you have spiritually triumphed in this life, and he, one of the rewards, is he's going to give you the crown of life. Do you look forward to that? Stay faithful to him. Because the truth is, you and I, we can overcome anything and everything when we are doing it for love, right? Love is an amazing thing, isn't it? As much as I love my wife, God's love is so much different in loving him. Because God loves us unconditionally. A lot of times we're like conditional, right? Let's just be honest, right? Sometimes there's conditions. I wish it weren't that way, right? You all know what I'm talking about? But God loves us unconditionally. No matter what we've done, no matter where we've been, no matter how it's done, he still loves us. He wants to rescue us from all that stuff. But he loves us unconditionally. And doesn't he deserve our devotion? He deserves our devotion. Because we love him because he first loved us. And we're willing to surrender to him. That means I'm willing to face whatever I have to face, knowing that I'm not going to be alone, that he will strengthen me, and he will bring me through it. And that's why James said, you know what, you just need to understand how blessed you are, because on the other side of it, God has a crown of life that you are going to be blessed with because you triumphed through this life. Amen? Oh, he's a good God, isn't he? Father, thank you for this day, and just thank you for your word, and thank you for your promises. Thank you, Jesus, for the cross today. Thank you for your perspective on understanding that any suffering that we do in this world, it's really about picking up our cross and following Jesus. That we're willing to go. We're willing to face whatever we have to face in this life. And so, God, I just pray this morning that if there's somebody here that's discouraged, I pray that they would have a divine perspective brought into their minds and their hearts today. And God, that you would do something that only you can do. You can change our minds. You can give us that perspective. You can bring revelation to us. So God, I pray that you'd reveal that to people right now. God, we just thank you that we can come before you today. Thank you for James. Thank you for his writings. Thank you for his teachings. To get us an understanding that life is not always going to be easy. Because the suffering in this world is very connected to the cross. And we are to pick up our cross and follow Jesus. So God, we just thank you for your promises. Thank you that those who endure will have the crown of life. And I pray that we would all in this place, that we would be numbered among them that would receive that. We love you today, and we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you please stand and sing the closing song with us? I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah my way.
So as you go today, I just want you to think about something. I don't know if you ever thought about this, but you remember when Moses went to high to the mountain and he experienced really closeness of God? He experienced the glory of God and being in his presence. And we know what it's like. We feel it today that we're being in God's presence. But can you imagine, like, when we are face to face with Jesus? Won't that be something? And I was thinking about that and the glory of God and just how it has to be so satisfying and so fulfilling just to be in his ever-presence forever and ever and ever. Yeah, I don't know about you, but I look forward to that. And I wanted to just leave you with this, what the Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 8. I'm just going to read a couple verses. He said, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time," which were a lot for him, "are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us." Receive this, will you? Receive this. Because for those he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that they might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he called. He called us by name. And to those he called, he also justified, made us right with him. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. We have a lot to look forward to. And compared to what we face in this present world, God's glory, I want to experience that into eternity. Amen? God bless you all, and you are dismissed.